So today I'm talking about preparing the students for the world through undergraduate research. So when I was an undergraduate, my first year in college, my first semester in college, I already had credit for a biology class, but I had to take this lab. And so my goal in lab was to be the first one done every time. So there was this one day where we were supposed to be measuring these the respiration rate of these cockroaches, and the cockroaches were about this big. Put them in this little container, and we had these mini little treadmills. We had to put the cockroaches on and make them run. And everyone else's cockroaches are strolling along, and my cockroaches are bolting down the way. And when I turned that lab in at the end of the class period, my TA called me over and said, "I need to talk to you." And I thought, oh no, I'm in trouble. And she handed me a flyer and said, "There's this program called the Howard Hughes Undergraduate Research Apprenticeship Program. You want to apply for that?" And I said, "Well, I don't want to be a doctor, and I don't know." And she said, "Really? Go do this." So a few months later, I found myself studying these circadian rhythms of hamsters. Turns out hamsters, on their natural cycle, have a 24-hour circadian rhythm. But this lab at UVA had determined that there were some mutant hamsters that had 20-hour cycles to them, that if they're left in the light or the dark all day long without any cues, they have a normal 20-hour cycle. And it turns out if you breed them together, you get 22-hour hamsters, some 20, some 24, and some 22 hours. So we were trying to figure out how that worked, and we thought we knew where in the brain that was. So we were, in fact, doing brain transplants on hamsters. We'd take the teeny tiny part of the hypothalamus that we thought was where the timing was, and we would switch it with one that had a different kind of timing in it. And it turns out it worked, right? The 20-hour hamster, you exchange it with a 24-hour hamster, and it suddenly had a new rhythm. And it's funny, I was telling my daughters about this yesterday, and they said, "Now, did it hurt?" Imagine it didn't actually hurt, but it must have been really disorienting to wake up and suddenly have like really strange world cycles when you were perfectly fine before. At the same time, I had talked to an anthropology professor. I was taking a class, and that anthropology professor had said, "You're kind of interested in this," and handed me a flyer and said, "We're having an archaeology field school. You should come do this." Remember back in the days when we handed people flyers? Okay. So I started working on a Monacan Indian burial mound that was being eroded in Orange County, Virginia. And so we were trying to rescue this. And we had research questions where we were trying to find out about whether or not, what the lives of these prehistoric Native Americans were, how they lived, what they did with the people when they died. And so my college career was shaped not only by the classes that I took that helped build the knowledge that I needed to be able to be good at this, but it also was shaped by this idea that I was involved in these two major research areas where we had real questions we were trying to answer. And that shaped everything I've done in my career. I'm a biological anthropologist now. I study cemeteries, but I study cemeteries from this broad perspective where we look at genetic information and we look at biological information and skeletal data and cultural data to be able to reconstruct the lives of the people who lived in those cemeteries. So it changed everything that I did. It also changed what I valued. So instead of going on to be, like, I need to be the most published person, what I wanted to do was influence the most undergraduates as a part of it. I wanted to give every undergraduate I could the same opportunities I had to be involved in participating in the creation of new knowledge. And so these are the two parts of my career that have shaped everything I've done since then. So today what I'm really going to be talking about is how we prepare undergraduates for the world through undergraduate research. So I want to talk first about how it's valuable for undergraduates and for faculty and for the universities, and then my utopian view of what this should look like in the real world. So for undergraduate students, let's place this in the university, right? Universities are unique locations because they have two roles. We have the role of being educators of a whole new generation. And we do it in an environment where we're also the producers of new knowledge. We are the place where new ideas come from. And so what we need to do is we are in places where we need to connect those two roles with one another so that the students are a part of that production of new knowledge. And so with undergraduate students, this helps move. And we talked about today I've been just transfixed by listening to Monique's students who have been doing this, and the students who've been in the plays and are in these classes. At the same time, my daughter spent earlier today, they were working with undergraduate students in the game design program, testing their games. And these are undergraduates today who have been putting together this conference. This is the research of their experience. So when I'm talking about this, it's the scholarly knowledge all the way across the university. It's doing biological research in a lab, it's being a part of a play, it's doing archaeological digs, it's being a part of any of the work that goes on at the university. We have students who built bridges. One of them said, I want to show you what I'm doing. And I said, great, can you bring it over? And they said, sure, it's a 17-foot-long bridge. Like, maybe I'll come to you. So the kinds of things we're talking about are the things that are going on in a university to be able to connect these students with real-world kinds of skills. So the things that students learn when they're doing this, they learn these research skills where students get to learn, it's not just about doing things, but it's about learning how to ask the questions, right? Knowing how to phrase a question and then what you would do about getting it. In the era of big data, right, this is one of the things we need to know. The data is often there. It's how do you interpret it? What kind of questions to ask out of it? Another thing that we know students need to do is communication. It's important that students know how to tell the difference between what to tell grandma over the table at Thanksgiving versus how to talk to a colleague about what they're doing, the different genres of how they're going to communicate about this. I remember the first time Mike Miniker handed me back an abstract, and I've always been a good writer, right? I got this abstract, it was one page, it was 150 words, and it was dripping with red. And I was horrified, like I'd never done anything that bad in my entire life, and he's like, it's not bad, it's just not the right voice for the kind of writing you're supposed to be doing. So teaching students how to be able to communicate to the audience about what they need to know is really important. Another value that we want to make sure that the students get out of it is they learn about a professional environment. And one of the things that I learned from that was that when we went out, people came in early and they stayed late and they loved what they did every day. They loved everything about it. Nobody was punching a time clock or saying you need to be here from now to then. It was, oh my gosh, I get to go in and do this thing. And there was this professional environment that they got to be in. And along with that, it meant that especially for students who weren't always a part of a university culture, they got to learn the culture of what it means to be professional, right? What does it mean to act and work in a professional environment? Along with that also came responsibility. That when you do this, you take responsibility for your learning, you take responsibility for projects, and handing this over is really important for students to be able to take that responsibility. When we talk about, we talk to students and we've been getting some data on some of the programs we've been doing, and we found that we asked students one of the things, what the kinds of things I thought were important. 91% of our students who'd participated in undergraduate research program of any kind said that taking responsibility, taking initiative for their own learning was more important after being a part of this process. And the other thing that they learn is resilience. Everybody in here today has talked about things that failed at some point. And having the ability to understand that failure is okay, that failure is a part of the learning process, is really important. That resilience is one of the things we really need. And in that same survey we did of students, 95% of the students said they were more comfortable dealing with obstacles than they were before they participated in an undergraduate research program. That's pretty spectacular, and we need people who have that kind of resilience. And one of the things that I also think is important is when I walked out of being an undergraduate and having done this, I knew what was important to me, but I didn't know how important it was going to be long term. So one of the things, even when we're asking students about it now, we're not measuring the long term impact, but we know that these things are going to have an impact for the rest of their lives. For faculty, there's significant value too. One of my colleagues is a guy named Lapato, who's a psychologist who studies the impact of undergraduate research. I'm going to read this because I love it. He says that an interdisciplinary, problem-centered, research-centered undergraduate curriculum promises to change the focus of a faculty member from teaching versus research dichotomy to a more unified, fully functioning approach to education. This is a way for faculty, if you understand, got their PhDs in a subject that they love, often with very little instruction on how they were going to be teaching. But here's where they finally get to bridge that gap, where they suddenly are able to bridge what they got a PhD because they love this stuff, and now they've got people who love it with them, right? And it's a way to be able to bridge that gap. So for faculty, being able to offer opportunities for undergraduate research is to be able to bridge the gap of what universities do. The other thing it does is it turns out undergraduates don't have to have data to graduate like graduate students do. They have a really high tolerance for failure because really the process is what's more important to them than the product. That learning how to do this is more important, and as they know, there's a lot of data to show, as long as they know why they're doing even the sort of semi-menial tasks that go along with things, then it turns out they get great value out of it. But they have a high tolerance for failure. So faculty members, this is a great time for students to be able to try a new protocol, to do a first draft, to work on a project for the first time, to get pilot data. And it's a really good example. One of our faculty members in theater came to us and said, I've got this project, we've got these drawings from the WPA period, and I need somebody to help me organize them and look at them and think about what kind of questions we can do. It's Howard Kurtz, and he got an undergraduate student who's been working with them this semester, and they did exactly that. He said, it's been wonderful. And he just applied for a national fellowship to be able to continue studying this collection of costume drawings that he's been looking at. And it turns out he was the only person awarded this fellowship this year, and it was based on the pilot data that he and the student did. So we often think of pilot data as being something that we see in the sciences, but undergraduates can help provide that all the way across the curriculum. So it's good for that, but also universities. The things we talk about for universities is we want to improve recruitment, right? That we want to get the best students in our universities. And so one of the things, there are eight things that the U.S. News and World Report, which is like the thing that at least the parents of new students look at all the time. One of the eight things they tell people to look at is whether or not there are opportunities for students to participate in the scholarly work of the institution. So we know that students are looking at that, and at least their parents are asking those questions and know to look at them. So having that visible to them is really important for recruitment. Another thing that we're looking at is retention. Right now, with the big federal pushes, it's not just getting students in the doors, it's also getting them all the way through to graduation. University of Michigan did a great study a few years ago where they were looking at students who got involved in undergraduate research early. And what they found was there was a 20% increase in retention, especially minority students, if they had participated versus not participating in this. That meant instead of 50-some percent of them graduating, 70-some of them persisted through to graduation. And it wasn't because they had published anything, it was because they had participated in this. So, and the other thing, sort of that grounds of things that are really important. Undergraduates who have a unique connection with a faculty member are more likely to be alumni who give back to the university. They've made a connection, they've got a relationship, and they're going to be alumni who care about the institution. And that's a really important point when we're thinking about how to fund the university for many years. So we know that undergraduate research is valuable for students, we know it's valuable for faculty, and we know it's valuable for institutions. So that leads me to think about sort of what should it look like for a university to do this. And this is informed by my experience. I did undergraduate research. I've been a faculty mentor for over 50 students. In fact, when I'm leaving here, I'm going to look at the poster my student and I are doing for our meetings next week. I've directed undergraduate research in a small comprehensive university at this big research university, and I work with the Council on Undergraduate Research. So I'm involved in this conversation, and what I'm going to talk about is really an ideal world of what we want to shape undergraduate research opportunities across to look like. And I want to go back to that idea that, first of all, we're talking about diversity and accessibility. That, first of all, diversity is diversity in all kinds of things. That means that if the university does it and asks its faculty members to do it, students should have the opportunity to do it also. Every discipline, every kind of work, undergraduates should be able to do that work. We also mean that every kind of undergraduate should be able to do it. Not just the honors students, not just the students who come from the suburbs or have faculty parents or any of those kinds of things, but first generation non-English speaking students should also have the opportunity to do this. And in fact, the University of Michigan study showed that students who were less prepared by the ways we talk about prepared for college had the greatest gains by participating. So accessibility, this idea of accessibility and diversity is really important. And in fact, in my own experience, it turns out that the student who's gotten a 4.0 is often not the perfect student to be participate in undergraduate research because they're very good at following directions, but they don't test boundaries very often. And being able to ask a good question is really important. And so being able to spread the opportunities across the student population is really important. So I think, first of all, those two things that I talk about is this idea that this is diversity and accessibility. That also means that it has to happen within and beyond the classroom. So there's got to be the opportunity to be able to build skills in the classroom and participate in authentic research, research where we don't know the answer, the faculty member nor the student, in the classroom and beyond the classroom. And when you look at student populations now, they're older, they're more diverse. That kind of thing, to be able to be both in the classroom and beyond, is really important. So some ways of being able to do this is, it first of all, it's got to start early. My goal, my personal goal, is there should never be a student who attends college who ever walks away going, my professor only works 9 hours a week, right? Because they should understand that what faculty are doing all the other time is they're preparing for classes and they're producing new knowledge. They're the ones who are writing the things or doing the things that they're finding in their textbooks. They're the ones who are figuring out the protocols they're testing in their labs. The faculty members are doing this with every minute of their lives. They think and dream this stuff, and that their students should understand that. So that should start early on. Faculty should be talking about it in their classes. Students should be hearing about these opportunities the first time they step in a classroom. That also means we should be building these skills and giving more sort of flexibility in the curriculum to be able to build these in, so that students, especially who don't start all at the same place, have that ability to participate through their curriculum. We've talked about, professors should talk about what they do when they're not in the classroom. One of the things I'd like to see is, I'd love to see federal work study money always being given to faculty members to have assistance in the class for their research, so that students start early and these things that seem like they're sort of well and beyond, all the things that they're worried about in terms of like the grunt work of research, is something that, as long as the students are participating and understand the questions, that's a great way of getting the students involved. So the other thing that we should be talking about is, we should understand that students, not every student has to publish for this to be a value to them. So students should be able to be involved at the level that's of interest to them. When we ask students early on about what they've learned about research, 97% of them said, learning about research or creative activities makes me more curious about the world. 97% of our students said that. And 90% of them said, as they got involved in research, that it was fun to work on hard problems. No, those are the people I want leading the world in the next few years. We want people who know that it's fun to work on hard problems. We also want to ask faculty to ask them in interviews when we first hire them about what they're going to be and what their plans are for being involved in having undergraduates help them with their research creative activities. We should review them every year on that, and we should tenure and promote them as that being an important criteria. And the last part of that is, we should think of librarians in this world of information. We should be thinking of librarians as being partners in that educational process, so that we're talking about how to look at data. So with that whole view in mind, what I want to sort of close with is this idea that Jim Gentile of the Research Corporation sees the world as being problem-centered on issues that transcend disciplinary boundaries. And if the world is a place that's problem-centered and without disciplinary boundaries, we want students who are capable of being able to deal with that. Of our students who have been working on research, 98% said research can solve real-world problems. This is fabulous. We know that they think they can do it. And 99% of our students say advances in the scholarship can make the world a better place. That's what we want. Instead of diplomas or instead of credentials, what we really need to do is give students experiences and relationships that allow them to be able to think of how they're going to be better skilled for the world, and that give them the opportunities to solve real-world problems that can help make the world a better place. So when I think of undergraduate research, I think of it as students who are being prepared for the world. Thank you.